What's up, everyone? Kawaiiku here, and welcome to episode 4 of the Weebs of the Mini Table podcast. In this podcast, we are going to be doing something a little bit different. So, instead of talking about the entire summer 2021 season, for now, we are only going to be talking about four shows. Four very specific shows. And those shows are going to be Slime, Season 2, Part 2, Kobayashi Dragon Maid, Season 2, Mom Next Life as a Villainess, Season 2, and Love Life Superstar. So joining me right here is Oliver Smiley, Mad Lad of Culture, and someone who actually was on a podcast before back in the summer 2019 season, but hasn't really appeared since, but she is here now, Queen Deja. So yeah.
Hey.
Without further
ado.
Hi. Hello. Welcome back,
Queen Deja.
So without further ado, let's get to it. So as always, let's start off at the very top of the list and work our way down. So let's start off with Slime, Season 2, Part 2.
Hey.
So what do you guys think?
Hey. So yeah, Slime is over, but no need to fret, everyone. There is a movie sequel coming out next fall.
There's a movie coming next year. And I think it was like, they did announce the season, I think it's coming in. I think it was like spring.
No, fall season.
It'll be fall.
Fall next year. So it'll be a year's wait, but it's worth it anyway. Since season two is like a perfect season, in my opinion. Just the best way to close off Slime for the time being. Go play the game. By the way, they're right now promoting the game, so just go and play the game. I think the game is somewhat...
Or go read the light novel.
Canon. I think I heard the game... People say the game is somewhat canon in some ways. I was like, what? How is that possible? So... Yeah, you can say you can go and play the game or read the light novel or read the manga version. There's a manga version, by the way. So, yeah, I mean, Slime this season.
No, I've actually been told don't read the manga version because it's actually not up to date with where it's currently at.
So, that's what I heard too, man.
I went and bought all 11. Light novels of
$130.
But come on, it's all like 11. This is up to date. These are all
fair enough. I guess
it's worth it.
Fair play for you though. I still haven't like really like caught up with my Dear Alive light novel reading. I'm still on volume like 15, so I really need to catch up with my Dear Alive reading. So yeah, you can say to be honest, the light novel is not really my thing. Like I only properly fall in one light novel, and it's just Dear Alive. So I mean, I read other light novels before, like Sword Online, Aria Feretta, but I just dropped off from reading it. So I'm more of a manga person. So. Yeah, I mean, going back to Slime, though, I gotta say, this season, part two of season two, I mean, obviously...
They went off the chain with this one, like...
Okay, hold up, let me ask. Was it better than season one? Because I didn't watch season two.
Okay. Yeah, it's better than season one, in my opinion. 100%.
Parts one and two of Slime, season two, were amazing.
Okay.
Trust me. I did not like season one at all. I didn't remember much from season one. I don't remember much from season one, but season two, oh man,
I
love it so much.
Barely remember ish, but yeah, I like enjoyed season one a lot. But yeah, might have to watch season two.
Yeah, you should because like season two, like take it to the next level in terms of like storytelling.
Okay.
Rimuru basically become more OP. So
yeah, extremely OP now.
So yeah, you can just see how Rimuru, and of course you can also see Rimuru being pissed off. Like you see Rimuru being pissed off in season one at all. In season two, oh man, you love it.
He gets beyond being pissed off.
Yeah.
I don't think we have a term of the of what Rimuru, how angry Rimuru was in season two.
Oh, trust me. It's a fun watch, man. Watching Rimuru being in that stage of the season is just like, bruh, dude, Rimuru, calm. I know you're angry, but dude, calm. But yeah, he can say he has every right to, and every of them, not just Rimuru though, every people that follows Rimuru also get the moment to shine too, especially like the orcs, yeah. So I mean, hey, even Gabiru gets a moment to shine too, so that shows how good season 2 was. And yeah, I gotta say though, season two has been take the storytelling to the next level. Part two though, the thing I don't really like about part two is that the meeting got dragged out too long, man.
Yes, okay. Yeah, they have a lot of meetings in part two, and it just drags. Like some of the meetings are important. It's like, don't get me wrong, it is important because like it actually sets up like events for like season three. Mm-hmm. Or the movie and the movie and stuff, but yeah, they could have just easily just gone, okay, this, we don't really need all of this meeting, let's just give you the highlights of the meeting, boom, let's move on. But gotcha. No, they're just like, all right, keep going. It's like, literally we hit half the
you
season.
You basically want them to wrap it up like quickly so you can move on to the next thing.
I really feel like the meeting could have just like condensed to like three episodes.
Like six or seven episodes of pure meeting.
No, just six episodes.
It was just six episodes of just them talking. And like, can we get to the fighting already? Like, come on.
maybe the fact that, I mean, I guess I said that in my video, if my subscriber literally came at me and said, dude, Mala, do you understand the importance of the meeting and the importance of dialogue?
Yeah, that happened to me as well. Yeah, a lot of people came forward like, actually, this is really important, so
because from what I can see though, like the meeting part kind of like doesn't really set up for the water parade though, it's more set up for the future events to come, like Rimuru the bond with like the kings and the other kingdom. I guess they said that they can have a contribution to like later in the volume how they're gonna cooperate to deal with this matter, so that's why they really establish this sort of like political friendship with other kingdoms too, before he start to like attack Clayman, because you can't just really go in and attack Clayman and just say, oh yeah, you want to see Clayman die? Here we are, guys. And then the second, and then the whole season is basically pointless. So basically, I can totally understand the whole meeting part, but it's just that I feel like it could have been four episodes. Like, just get straight to the point rather than just do this and that. But again, though, like, it's important just to see how Rimuru establish himself in the world and just... Of course, you also introduced like the hierarchy standing in the world too, and just see how everything goes for the time being before everything resets off after in the movie maybe. So, I mean, although I gotta say the meeting part was okay to be honest, but if I should be very critical about it, the Water Purist fight though and the war, I was kind of disappointed. I was a bit disappointed actually. Like, we were expecting something very grand, like some big battle. I mean, we get some good fights, but the fight is a bit too one-sided. It was really one-sided.
Was really one-sided, but
it was a bit, like, I had a
sort of argument with La Games about this, because after I watched the second last episode, I actually really liked that episode so much that I went and watched some other reactions to it. So I watched Memory's reaction to it. I haven't gone to your one yet, Mad Lad.
I also watched
La Game's reaction to it, and like La was like, you know, Rashion fighting Clayman, like he was just like, ugh, should have been Milim or Rimuru fighting Clayman. It shouldn't be Shion, like, dude.
Dude, Shion needs to have her payback.
He doesn't. Seriously, he doesn't get it because he's so fixated on breast size. He's like,
because of course he is.
It's like, yeah, because it's because he thinks Shion is a shit character because of it. And like, have you not been paying attention at all?
Bruh. How dare a woman has breasts? Oh, the horror!
Oh, the horror! He's a pet tanko. He's interesting to. Oh my god. Oh, I mean, come on, man. Shion had need to have a moment to shine, man. She need a moment to like, beat up Clayman.
Look, I even brought up a really good argument with him. Like, on my Discord, I actually, like, tagged him and just, like, wrote this massive argument of why it needed to be Shion fighting Clayman in that fight. Because we know how powerful Milim is. We know how powerful Rimuru is. We don't know actually how powerful Shion is, especially after the events of Season 2, Part 1. Mm-hmm. So this is the perfect time to see just how powerful Shion has become because of the upgrade that she got. And it was perfect. Like, that was one of the best fights I've seen, honestly. Like, Shion was not having it with Clayman at all. And I loved it. Yeah, Law was just like, yeah, whatever.
Whatever. Law. I mean, people have their opinions, though, to be honest. But
I know,
But I gotta say, though, like, I was quite hyped up when Rimuru and Milim was fighting, but in the end, they're just trying to save Milim, though. But in the end, Milim, I mean, I cannot really spoil it, though, because Queen hasn't watched it yet, but...
Yeah.
But the thing about... The Milim case, though, I was like, bruh, so you were a double agent this whole time? Oh my god. So, it was just like, wow. Totally, almost saw it coming.
Like, so... memory apparently seems to have figured out that, you know, what was going on with Milim. But I didn't figure it out until, like, it was revealed. I was, like, shocked that was the actual reveal.
I mean, I kind of suspected, but I didn't really mention in my video because I didn't want to, like, trigger the comment section, so... I just keep it simple. Just let the comments do the thing, and then I just during the intro at the next video, I just say the stuff you guys have been telling me. So that's usually how I do with my review section. Just keep it simple, then wait for the comment section to come in, and then I repeat what the comment section say in the next video. So
yeah, that's what I do as well. If somebody brings up a good point in the comment section for the previous video, I try to address it at the start of the next one.
So, yeah, I mean, the whole Water Prince meeting, though, to be honest, the Clayman just there. That was just there to just, you know, meet his end, basically, because we finally get to see him being vulnerable. Like, he was actually really weak. I did not expect that. I thought he would put up quite a fight, though, in the end, but...
I kind of figured out that he was meant to be weak, though. Compared to both the other, you know, demon lords.
And it's just that the way that he speaks, though, and the way he acts, it's just like, I feel like, maybe he does have some sort of hidden talent in him or something, but guess not. He just goes berserk, and then Rimuru just do one punch man, and just he's defeated.
Like... What gave it away for me was that the reason why I figured out he was so weak is the point where he has to, like, bring in other people to fight for him. That's a giveaway that, yeah, this guy is so weak that he needs other people to fight for him. This is not going to be a massive fight.
I mean,
in fact,
bringing other people just to ensure that, you know, there's an equally match about numbers, because like Rimuru also brought in his people too. But I mean, I can see where you're going with this, though. But again, though,
it's funny that you bring up the, like, in the last episode, it's pretty much going to be just, I'm expecting the fight to not even last 5 minutes. It's just going to be done and dusted in like one. Rimuru's just going to walk up to Clayman and just punch him, and he's just going to be wiped out. So that's what I'm kind of expecting.
I mean,
like, I really don't expect the entire episode to be this fight at all.
Well, hopefully you get to witness the fight later on. But yeah, you can say the final episode, though. I mean, yes, going into it, I thought it would be a massive big finale fight. But turns out it turns out to be a big finale conclusion. So it's just, you know, everything settled down. Demon lords do their thing, do this and that, and of course establish their cohesion and their political ties with others, demon lords, and then the credit.
But there's also the fact that after this fight, there's still
one more. But I'm not gonna say about it.
There's two more. There's two more. quote-unquote enemies we need to deal with, or women we need to deal with.
Yeah, yeah.
Because
but
there's still the church.
And the clown.
Then there's... No, no, not really the clowns. I wasn't going to bring them up, but the other guy. The one behind Clayman.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, the one that manipulates Yuki, basically.
Yeah, Yuki is, I think his name is. I was going to say, hey.
Yeah, there's two of, there's two of them.
Were you watching Slime?
Hello? Kawhi?
Hello? Oh, Kawhi. Oh, you're talking to me? Oh, okay. No, I wasn't. No, because your mic was cutting out for me, so I wasn't sure. Like, no, I'm not watching Slime.
Oh, okay.
You're not watching Slime. Okay. All right. Just making sure.
But yeah, I gotta say though, like, there's still more enemies to come for Rimuru, but he's pretty sure he can deal with them anyways. I mean, of course, Hinata is still the biggest threat though, because, you know, she literally go toe to toe with Rimuru, and I'm pretty sure that's not really her full potential. She's still got more hidden talent in mind, but. Yeah, I gotta say though, I think the next thing that Rimuru has to deal with now is the church, because the church,
the church is now the biggest threat, I think.
Going to the whole aspect of Rimuru versus like Clayman though, like, yeah, you can say the fact, I can totally see Clayman as being such a wimp in the end though, because like, trust me, there is a scene in the fight that you just to say, oh my god, that so he was actually that weak. So, yeah, I mean, I'll let you witness yourself later on, Oliver,
but
I gotta say, the finale though was a very more of a cool down episode, actually. It was more of a cool down episode. And we get to see another Demon Lord. Well, kind of get to see another Demon Lord, and then we get to see this very scene at the near the end of the episode before we cut to the wholesome end. Before Rimuru said, "I'm in this world as a slime," and movie sequel announced, yay! So yay! I mean, looking forward to the movie, of course. But I gotta say, the Slime Season 2 Part 2, I would say Part 1 is better though, in my opinion, in terms of like the drama aspect. And Rimuru becoming.
Oh, you mean Part 1 of Season 2, you mean?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Part 1 of Season 2. Season 2, Part 2 was just like, was kind of a bit disappointed with the whole build up to it though, because like some of the stuff I was expecting to be good, but just turns out to be more just sort of like.
Short fair, fight. Season 2, Part 1 got really dark. So we kind of expected Part 2 to be.
The resolving part.
Well. Yeah.
But yeah, I gotta say though, I really prefer Part 1, man. Part 1 really did it for me. As a person that witnessed something that is eye-opening for Slime series, because like I thought Slime is just gonna be another one of those like wholesome world building series.
Yeah, I think a lot of people thought that was going to be the case. And I now agree what Memory said with the idea that what Slime really is about is the world building. It's about how Tempest evolves into this massive kingdom.
Well, we kind of saw that in Season 1 already, so...
I know, but like you can really start seeing it happen in Season 2 a lot more than in Season 1. So I actually agree with Memory now about that.
The whole world building part. Season 2 introduced a new concept to it, and then the Part 2 is just like, just calm things down, show how Rimuru deal with the situation, deal with the threat, and then, you know, expand the world a bit more. They get to see other Demon Lords too, and how they function and the history around the whole world. Because like we also learn a bit about Million's backstory too. So that was a really good part, I guess. So yeah, I'll be very much looking forward to see how the story takes on from this point on too, because like, I mean, we dealt with Clayman now, but it's just like, who's going to be the next big threat? Maybe like the one that Clayman was working for maybe, or like Yuki and the other, and the one another Demon Lord, which I forgot his name. So yeah, I'm kind of curious.
Yeah, I know who you're talking about. The one that brought Shizu to the to this world, right?
No, another one. I don't think we saw him yet, but yeah, I've been very much looking forward to the movie when it's available online.
Well, we need to wait for it to be. Not only do we need to wait for it to be released, we also have to wait for it to be subtitled.
Yeah,
true. Trust me, fan subs are crazy nowadays. They're like fan subs that I never heard of. So I just like, okay, I just watch them anyways. I understand Japanese anyway, so I can go along with it. The subtitles just allow my viewers able to follow along anyway. So, yeah, Slime Season 2 Part 2 though. Yeah.
I really enjoyed it.
It's basically the show that saved the summer season. Even if Slime did not have air in the summer season, then the summer season, in my opinion, is kind of like meh. But I guess of Slime,
I agree with that because yeah, Kobayashi's Dragon Maid, which we'll be talking about shortly, was amazing to see that again. But yeah, it didn't really save the season.
I can say the fact that Slime and Makia Record is my show for the season. To be honest, man, Makia Record really saved my season.
I haven't seen any of that. I haven't seen any of that series.
Because Slime, Kobayashi, and what other is there? Vanitas is just like
Love Live.
Yes, Love Live, but we can get into that later. But Vanitas is like the show that I was like, when I look at the list back in like June, I was like, yes, some decent show to save the season. But then Market Record comes in, I was like, yes, my summer is saved. Because I absolutely love Market Record. I got two posters in my room, but you guys cannot see it. But yeah, so that's why I say, yeah, you can say summer season isn't that bad. But then comparing it to winter and the spring season, is like, it's down there, to be honest. But who knows? Maybe the fall season could be like equally as kind of meh. But we shall see. But yeah,
I'm not watching anything from the fall season, so I'm not reacting to anything from the fall season. I should say. I'm not reacting to anything from the fall season. I am watching stuff from the fall season, but I'm not reacting to any of it. Because the one show that I was going to react to in fall has been moved to 2022.
We can get into that later. Just to end of the podcast. I need to rant about that, by the way. I need to just
rant. That's gonna be it.
Let's do Kobayashi next. Welcome back, Kony.
4 years, man.
They knocked it out of the freaking park.
Oh my god.
Exactly. That is 100%.
Good. Like, I was worried because like when they're coming back with Kobayashi, say, oh my god, they don't have the staff. They worked on it before, but you know they come back strong. Their new recruits really proved their potential. I was like, oh my god, KyoAni just being KyoAni, just give us quality
and
after
then,
quality.
I know.
And then when it started airing, in the opening credits, them like actually
they credited the director.
Yeah, they pay respect to the season one director.
That was really sweet of them to actually do that.
Mm-hmm.
Oh man, I gotta say, like, seeing KyoAni back again, that kind of opens the door for more shows to return slowly, of course. I mean, Kobayashi, because it was already announced, like, literally, like, 3 years ago, it's just because of the incident they had to delay to this year. So that's why, I mean, the next one is free, by the way. The next thing they're working on is free, the movie.
Mm-hmm.
So I think after free, they can, like, finally have this sort of flow of releasing animes now. So I'll be looking forward to more of their work in the future. But free's next, everyone. Free's next. So one more KyoAni stuff.
I haven't watched any of free, so...
Don't watch Yaoi Swimming. I love free, but... Hey, guys, I love free, okay? So I'm going to watch the movie when it comes out. But, yeah, going back to Kobayashi, though, like, the first episode, dude... Literally go right in, man. Irulu versus Toru.
They already started with the action, the unexpected action. It was amazing.
Oh my god.
Am I the only one who's read the manga?
Yeah, I think you are.
I have it. Yeah, okay. Maybe.
Okay.
I'm going to say anime only for Kobayashi.
Because I actually went and had a look back through the chapter list of, you know, of Kobayashi, and I've actually realized that they actually jumped around the chapters.
Makes sense, I guess.
Like, it wasn't like, oh, chapter 86, 87, 89, etc. It was like chapter 86, 90.
They did the same for Kaguya-sama. They did the same for Kaguya-sama.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Kaguya-sama did skip chapters. Like, each episode has an episodic to it, and then like a carryover episode. Yeah, they skip chapters. I have a manga reader for Kaguya-sama, so I know this. So, yeah, I mean, it kind of makes sense that this season is so wholesome, if you think about it, compared to the first season. I mean, considering
the fact in this season, what do we have in this season? Oh, yeah. Kobayashi became a man for an episode.
Two episodes.
Then we went to New York and had the kidnapping subplot.
Mm-hmm. So, why New York? Wow.
Yeah, Kana went all the way to New York just because she argued with Kobayashi.
Yes.
If only we can do something like this, like, overnight. Just fly all the way to New York.
But seriously, I have to give Kony a lot of props to actually, you know, not only adapt those chapters, but they actually, no joke, toned them down quite a bit. Because especially the Kobayashi becoming a man in the manga, it's
a lot edgier.
I remember we actually talked about this during the last podcast because I remember saying that, you know, in that one scene,
I don't really want to reveal too much, but I will say in one of the latest chapters I read, it happened again.
Oh
wait!
Yes.
Oh wait. Shit!
It
oh shit! Oh shit!
Time.
Oh shit!
It happened again, and this time it was pure accident.
Oh my god!
Yes.
Oh my god!
This time.
Well, that's interesting.
That's interesting.
I really do hope they announce a third season, though. I know it's probably going to be a while before.
To be honest, I kind of see it as like they're going to release like those mini episodes again, because those
the mini episodes are still going.
Yeah, I think they're just going to stick to the mini episode for the time being, because like I said, they're working on the bigger project like Freed right now, so they might as well keep it small.
I think the mini episodes only go up to episode 8, though, so we only have like two or three episodes left of the minis.
Well, we shall see, because like I'm really enjoying the mini stuff right now, even though it's only like 3 minutes. Like, what the hell, man? Like 3 minutes of Kobayashi, I was like, okay, can I have longer, like 7 minutes maybe, but oh well. Just enjoy what it is, man. Queens, what do you think of this season?
I mean, I thought it was really good. As someone who watched it, like, what, so many freaking years ago? It feels like forever. And just having it back was just really good. I mean, I enjoyed it a lot. I cried, I laughed and everything. It was just really good. Very wholesome and sweet. All I really cared about was Kana for the most of the time.
Going back to season two, though, the thing I like about season two that every character get the moment to shine.
Especially Elma, man.
That's one of the biggest things I love about season two is because like they give us so much more character development for like a lot of other characters, like Elma, you got Lukua, Fafnir, and all that.
Yeah.
It really brought something new to the table, like, you know, as a postseason win. Because, you know, season two, we got a lot more character development, more world building, a lot more action as well. I'm going to say, I said this on Twitter, I'll say this again. If Kyo Ani doesn't make, like, a battle shonen anytime soon, like, they have the stuff. They have the potential. Like, it's only a matter of time.
Not to mention, like, side characters like Shota get a lot of screen time this season.
That's true.
I don't want to reveal too much about what's going to happen next, but if they do make a third season, I think the one that's going to get a lot more backstory will be Kana. Kana will get a lot of backstory.
Okay. Wow. Yeah. That makes sense.
Ooh.
Yeah. Kana, if they do a third season, it's Kana that's going to get a lot of the story.
That's perfect. I mean, there's more Kana fans than any other dragons.
Again, this is why I was very curious to see where exactly season two would end, because I did hint at this in the last podcast in terms of Kobayashi, but if they do adapt the third season, it's going to get, when it comes to, let's say, Kana's story, it's going to get dark.
Damn, you're gonna make me cry.
Kana and dark. Oh, that's
dark.
Yeah.
Those are two things I don't expect to go together.
Kinda dark. There's a reason why I say that, but I don't want to reveal too much. So
okay, so kinda has a dark backstory. Interesting.
Kinda.
What happens? It depends. It's about what happens in Kana's arc.
I mean, we can get an idea from season one that she's got kicked out for her shenanigans and stuff like that. So, and of course, based on her like behavior during the New York episode too, you can kind of see what sort of stuff she might have done in the past with her parents and stuff like that. Maybe get to that sort of troublesome stuff. Some stuff, but again, though, I don't want to go into it. Say, oh my God, Kana actually suffered in the past, but maybe see when you say he's kind of gonna get like an interesting backstory. I say, maybe there is a chance that Kobayashi Dragon finally gonna show some potential. Like this season, we get to dive into Toru's backstory, which is really deep, by the way.
Yeah, that's something. One thing that really surprised me about that is because we got more into Toru's father. We got like development for Toru's father, which is something I didn't expect. I didn't even expect to see him again, let alone like get him some actual like development.
I thought for a second that Toru's father is here to like kidnap Toru again, but nope.
it's funny that you say that.
Oh.
Wait, is that related to like the manga or something?
Oh, too soon, Oliver.
Few chapters, they've actually gone and given us Elmer's backstory.
Didn't we already got Elmer's backstory?
No, you actually haven't. That's the thing. Like, it's going well. Maybe they have a little bit with the Toru part.
Yeah.
Like meeting Toru and all that, but what happened before that?
Oh, yeah, she did back in Elma's episode. Like, she just said that she once was fished out in the sea by people, something like that. Like, you know, like she was recalling her fish, you know, when she went fishing, she recalled a moment she got fished out of the sea by humans. Maybe something like that. Like, you know, she got tortured.
No, it's something else.
Interesting. Looking forward to that.
If that happens, it would Elmer's backstory will probably be explored in a season four.
Season four.
What?
Yeah.
Wait. Yeah. How many chapters does Kobayashi have right now?
It's in the. Hang on, I can just get it.
I'll check too. How many chapters?
Like, I think it's 103 or something.
That's like so many source material.
And how much did the animes cover?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, 109. 109 is where we're up
not
to.
Bad. Not bad. Wow, that's a lot of source material. Very interesting.
So how much did the anime cover?
Well, like I said, it jumped around this season, but...
It jumps around.
Pretty much, yeah. Like, let me... You know what? I'm curious now when... Like, for example...
Because I might have enough for a third season.
I think it already has. It already has enough for a third season, 100%. Where are we? Kobayashi. There it is. Like, for example... I'll go for one of the, you know, episodes that were adapted this season. Where was it? So there's a lot of chapters. Oh, here we are. Elmer and Toru, that's that story, that the beginning of this season, that was volume 7, chapter 64.
What the hell?
Chapter 64.
Damn.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then, let's see. There was one. When was it? I saw it the other day.
So it's about like what? So it's about 60, 70 chapters over the course of two seasons?
Something like that.
Mm.
That's not bad. That's not bad at all.
No.
That's like enough for a third season indeed.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, sure. I mean, looking forward to more wholesome and then some dark stuff happening later on.
Maybe some more unexpected action as well.
Yeah.
I gotta say though, like, what is your favorite episode this season? I mean, starting with Queens.
Oh, okay. It's between kind of going to New York and pretty much the final episode. Yeah.
Connor in New York was chapter 62.
Oh, okay.
Well, hold on. I got one more. It's so episode 1, Kana's New York episode, and the final episode.
Oh,
those are
nice.
My three.
Kana in New York. I mean, my favorite episode has to be Elma's episode, to be honest.
Mm-hmm.
Elma's episode. That's
a great one.
Yeah.
Seeing that animated was really good, but also seeing Kana in New York was also adapted really well. Seeing that was really good. So those are probably my favorites from this season.
Flying all the
would
way
be
to
the final episode as well.
I like the fact how she able to make everyone speak Japanese. People they're actually speaking English. They were actually speaking English.
The poor baby, she couldn't understand.
I know. She's never been to America.
I know.
And then she tried to pay for a hot dog with yen. I'm like, oh, I'm so innocent. So pure.
Oh my God. Are you sure New York is that safe? No. Again, they did were she didn't face any trouble. Trust me, when I went to New York, I didn't have one of the best street experiences. Like, I was walking the street and it was like people were just rude. And in the anime, it's
they're hella rude in New York. I've been there. Oh. I went my senior year. It was good, but.
Oh my god!
I've never been to America, so I don't know.
Yeah,
when I was watching the New York and stuff, that it looks almost like it's just a normal city. There's nothing really going on, except for the whole capturing thing and get stuff like that. And like how she went from Minnesota to New York, I was just like, what the hell? Like, how do you went? Wow, that is some kidnapping right there, man. That is some kidnapping right there, indeed. But. Yeah, I gotta say, I really like how the aesthetic, the Central Park, the hot dogs, the what's the place called again with all the big commercials?
I think that's Times Square.
Times Square. Okay. Oh my god, that is just like, wow. The Statue of Liberty, that is just some quality Kyoani stuff, man. I just love it. I was hoping that we can do more of it, more overseas thing in the future. Like we maybe go to London, Paris, somewhere in Europe this time, or maybe South America. But well, maybe one day kind of rebels again. Kobayashi again, she flies to another part of the world. Maybe Sydney next time. Fly all the way to New Australia.
Or Kana goes to Florida, but then again, that might be a bit too dark.
No, fly to Hollywood. Fly to Hollywood.
All right, she's gonna see all the movie stars. She's gonna have her own star on the Hollywood strip.
But
Toru will be there in the background somewhere.
Yeah, watching.
Oh my god! Here's the funny thing. I actually went back and checked. They actually included her in the first scene. I was like, oh my god, it's not just an added scene during the recall. It's she's actually there. I was like, how did I not see it? Oh my god.
Yeah, that detail. She was there the whole time.
Yes.
Oh
man,
my god.
So sweet. But yeah, I think for me, my favorite episode would have to be. Oh, I don't even know what my favorite episodes are. I think
really?
Mine would have to be episode 11. That was great. You know, just seeing, you know, little Toru and you know,
oh
small Kana out there. That just just warms my heart.
That was good too.
And then yeah, it's episode 12 was also great. That was a great way to end the season, episode 12. Especially that moment when they played the first OP. I was like, oh my god, that was
oh my god.
Beautiful.
I gotta cry, man. That first OP, it just brings back memories of 2017.
I know, like, 2017.
When I first watched. I mean, you can also see the voice. If you guys watch like the voice actors like talk about the show, they actually cosplay as the dragon. Like, that shows how much they love the series, man. Oh my god, the voice actor actually really loved the role as the, you know, being the dragon girls and stuff like that. Like,
oh yeah, I would
they
imagine.
Talk really highly. They even make the MV of the first opening. Did you guys saw that video?
Oh, the first opening, the
voice actor, did the scene, not instead of Fana. So you guys saw that?
I've seen
a little bit.
I link it here. I just tag it here. I tag it in the chat. But dude, trust me, they were like so into the voice actors were like really into it, man. They love the role as the Kobayashi Dragon Maid, and especially like Toru's voice actor. She talked so highly of Toru, man. Like she really enjoyed voicing. She really enjoys being Toru more than any of other roles. I mean, mainly the fact that it helped her get her name out there too. But
that's true.
Let me just. So yeah, I mean, here I link it there, guys. The voice actor is doing the first opening.
Oh season. Yeah, I have seen that.
Dude, like when I saw that, I was like, whoa, that's just like cute as hell, man. They even got Kobayashi voice actor in there too. But I was actually hoping to see like what's his name again? Daisuke Ono.
Daisuke Ono
singing too. But I was like, oh man, you wasted it. Where's Daisuke Ono, man? Where's my man? Why is he not even?
It'd be even better if he did the dance back in like that one episode of season two.
Oh my god, why do you do Daisuke Ono, man? Why? Isn't he also part of the cast? Like, why? Like, the thing is, though, Fafnir Daisuke Ono is rarely actually appears in any Seiyuu shows for Kobayashi Dragon Maid for some reason, so.
He'd probably rather stay at home playing video games.
Or read JoJo. Or cosplaying. But yeah, I gotta say though, Kobayashi Dragon Maid season 2 is just like, just a return. I mean, oh yeah, before we say any more, Ilulu, what do you think of her?
I think she's a great addition. Yeah, I think she's a great addition to the cast. I mean,
here's your, be honest here. What do you think of her size?
Her size. You know what? You what? I mean, it's not
really
the,
not.
I'm not.
It's not bad.
I mean,
it's not bad at
yeah,
all.
I mean, I'm not like, you know, I don't like feel for her that way. Like, I'm not like sexually attracted to her or anything like that. But you know what?
I would hope
just,
not.
Yeah, I mean, I was like, you know what? I've just learned to accept it. I mean, it's not the first anime character we've seen with those kind of proportions, and it certainly won't be the last. So.
No, it's just because of her height and the size. It's just that like Twitter was exploding. Like, people
like,
just say,
on.
Oh my.
Most of us here, I'm assuming, watched Interspecies Reviewers, right?
Oh, yeah. True that.
I watched, like, one episode.
Oh, so, God.
Now, those are massive.
Very, very Sugoi
Dekai. Compared to Ilu, though, that's nothing, though. So,
I mean, she just said those are her fire set.
Yeah, I mean, they actually have a purpose. They actually are practical.
They actually made glow too in episode 1. I was like, oh shoot, wow,
that detail.
Oh my god, when I first saw that, I was like, oh my, I was pretty much blown away, because they actually found some like for them to actually include that, like they actually found some like practical use for a girl's big booba. I was like, wow, Kuyo-ari, man, that is just something else.
Hey, I mean, at least now her partner, what's his name again?
Take.
Take. He's having so much nose bleeding every day, man.
I know.
He's gonna die from blood loss. He's sooner than gonna die from blood loss.
He doesn't know how to act around her, which is even better.
Yes. But it's cute though.
I can really see Ilulu maybe fall in love with Take. I won't be surprised if it's gonna happen. Like, you can kind of see it happening anyways. Like, you know, the last episode where she said, "I'm gonna make an adult out of you." I was like, "Oh,
yeah, I remember." Really? I remember when I first saw really? Like Aru teasing Take. I was like, "Wow, this is basically like Uzaki-chan, the dragon version." Like, because it's literally just like a girl with big boobs teasing a guy who may not be in love with him. Like, it's basically Uzaki-chan, the dragon version.
Oh my god.
Yeah, that's a good point, actually, yeah.
That is a really good point. But I gotta say, though, I really love this sort of new dynamics between... every dragon got their partners now, I guess. Fana, I mean... Elma, except for Elma, though, her partner is food.
Her partner is a sweets, yep.
Yeah, that's all she cares about food. The other day.
That's the only thing she needs. She don't need people, food. She needs food.
She needs food. She needs food. All she does is eat. But again, though, maybe her new partner is Toru again, since those two kind of make up. But yeah. But, the whole season 2 part, though, I gotta say, is so laid back, man. You can just sit back and enjoy watching it and just enjoy laughing to scenes, though. So.
And the time just went by so quickly. Like, you start playing an episode and, like, 5 seconds later, it's over and you just go...
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Where did it all go? It's
over.
Where did it all go?
Where did it all go, man? Where did it all go, man? Wait, did any of you guys react to season 1?
I did. Yes, no. I did back in my old channel before I got terminated.
Same. Yeah.
Okay. So I mean, I watched season 1 back in 2017. It was actually one of the hottest talk show of that year too. Like, it was. I was actually part of the anime club, and people just can't stop talking about Kobayashi Dragon Maid. So you kind of show how big the show is, and seeing it return is just like a sign that Kyo Annie is bouncing back, because I actually like. When the Kyo Annie fire happened, though, I actually visited the studio when it got burned down. I actually visited the location, give my prayers, give the flowers. It's just like seeing all the fan art, seeing the Kobayashi Dragon Maid fan art. It just touched me, man. Just seeing how much people love Kyo Annie so much. It's just wow. Mm. Seeing that sort of push, seeing the investment from overseas too. Like, there was like a petition to like help give money for Kyo Annie, giving them the money to bounce back. It just shows how much people really value Kyo Annie, and seeing how they really cherish the anime really well too, and their staff too. Really shows that the quality really translate well into the anime. So that's what Kobayashi Dragon Maid is just like so happy to see return with the quality indeed.
It really brought the anime community together.
Again.
Yeah. And that's what's so surprising about season 2 is because, you know, because of that, after that incident happened, but like for them to like release season 2 like so soon after the incident was already surprising enough. But then to have it like maintain the same level of quality and that like the same level of charm and quality, like they're known for and what the series is known for is just it's so great, it's so awesome, and that's what I love about season. Another thing I love about season two is that usually when it comes to like a lot of other season twos, like I feel like some studios like they would just say, okay, we're just going to bring back what made season 1 so great. We're just going to call it a day. We're not going to bring anything new. We're just going to keep the same formula and call it a day. But I don't feel that way with season 2 of Kobayashi Dragon Maid, because like not only did they bring back the same charm, but they actually brought something new. Like, you know, we talked about, you know, the character development, and as well as, you know, they touched more action. They touched on some serious topics as well. Yeah, that's what I really love about this show, and that's why it's easily one of my favorite shows this season.
Very true, man. We just have to wait for another sequel announced, but for the time being, just enjoy the mini shows.
Mm-hmm.
I do think it's going to be a while before they announce the third season. Yeah. It's going to be a while.
Maybe next 2 years, I guess.
Yeah.
I guess.
Probably.
Because it was supposed to release like literally like 2 years ago or last year, but again, it got delayed because of the incident. So Yeah, I mean, come to think of it, the next Kill Annie that you get, that all you guys can watch is Violet Evergarden. It's coming out on Netflix next month.
Oh, really?
Wait, is it
the movie or?
Yeah, it's the movie.
The movie is coming out on Netflix next month. Can't wait to react to it.
Yeah, I know. I know Ryu's gonna be happy.
Trust me, he is gonna cry, man. We're gonna see real cry for the second time. Actually, I saw him cry before. But like, we're gonna see real cry for the second. Trust me, man. I can. Violet Evergarden is just a show that touches so many people's heart, man. It's just.
I have not yet seen it.
I haven't finished.
There's a lot of Kurani stuff that is on my plan to watch this, but I just haven't gone around to watching yet. Like, got Violet Evergarden, I haven't watched that yet. It's the other ones that they've done that.
Okay. So, shall we move on now?
Alright, so let's move on to My Next Life as a Villainess Season 2.
Hey.
That was a hot. Season 2 is a lot better than Season 1, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Nah, to be honest, for me though, Season 1, I still enjoy Season 1 more. There's some more darker stuff going on. Season 2, I don't know why, I just sit back and...
Season 2 has some dark stuff in it.
Yeah,
the last part of the episode. The last part of the episode, and then the start of the episode, and then that. Wait, all you guys watched Ultimate Game, right?
I haven't.
Oh, okay. But yeah, I mean, to be honest, though...
You mean the other Otome game? The horror one that... You mean that one?
No. I'm talking about Hamefura.
Villainess.
I watched season 1 and 2 of that.
Yeah.
I think
season 2 was a bit darker than season 1.
To be honest, though, I kind of enjoy season 1 more. I kind of dropped off the reaction because, like, I wasn't, like, really feeling it this time.
My Next Life as a Villainess isn't really reaction worthy, though.
Well, I mean, it depends on the people, though. But I can say I really enjoy the show on its own because, like, I don't know why, except for the last two episodes, every episode's been quite episodic. I mean, except for the start of the season and the last part of the season, the episode is quite episodic. I mean, the one thing I like about this season is that we finally get to see Katarina finally feeling the love. She finally know what she no longer the dense girl now. She's aware that the boys are after her now.
She's still dense. She is still dense.
She is.
No, I can see that she's starting to. I can see that she's starting to be aware of her relationship status now. Like, dude, she blushed. Hey, she blushed for once. I guess she blushed when she meets. What's his name again? Fuck.
Sora.
Not Sora. Keith. His own brother. His own brother, man.
Stepbrother.
Like, he's blushing now. I was like, oh my god. This is not happening. This is definitely not happening. This is not domestic Nakanojo all over again.
Oh no. That doesn't sound good.
Like, the last scene of the scene from the last episode is just like, oh god, it's don't tell me she's starting to show signs of interest. Hopefully not, but so far the leading line is Stuart Giordo. Yeah, I think he's the leading one right now, and everyone is just trying to get him away from Katarina.
Well, that's clear everyone wants her for themselves.
Although I gotta say though, Nicholas where he go for the marriage interview and stuff like that, I was like, wow.
That was deep, so good.
That was deep. That was holy shit! I was expecting that to be very like. Who's the friend called again? What's the friend name?
Mary.
No. The dark hair girl.
Maid.
Who's he again?
Dark hair.
What's her name?
It's not on the cast list.
But yeah, Katarina's friend, like, dude, she talks sense, man. Holy cow, she really talks sense into the whole relationship thing going on. And while I was like, bruh, that is deep, man. I was sitting back, was like watching it, then she started talking about this with Katarina, your true feelings and stuff like that. I was like, oh, wow. I was sitting on my chair and just, that's deep. That's deep, man. Well, obviously I didn't react to it, but you can say I was just shocked by that scene. The scene too, the sunset, I was like, whoa. That is some quality stuff from Silver Link, man. That is some quality animation from Silver Link, indeed. But
what I also like is that Katarina just needs to be like, this has to spend like 5 minutes of anyone, and they would fall for her within like that 5 minutes. It's just like she managed to like get her own harem, for pure ease. Like even the girls want her.
Like, oh my god!
Everyone just has to hug her.
Not just the girl. Even the maid. Okay. Even the maid.
Oh shit!
Her.
It's just everybody.
Everybody wants her. Okay.
Yo, that
even people like above her, the age range too, like wants her too. I was like, oh my god, she's creating a harem that she just. Being very dense about it now, but at least she's kind of aware now with the two boys that into her now, so
yeah.
She's kind of aware. So I mean, hey, Giardo made the first move. He did the Chad move. She kissed her in front of everyone. That was like whoa, chill boy, flexing already, man. Flexing it. I love the reaction, by the way. I love everyone's reaction, especially the girl's reaction. I gotta say, though, this season, though, I mean, at least we're making progress with Katarina being more aware of her situation, I guess. But other than that, though, just episodic wholesome and just, like, seeing Katarina being Katarina.
Well, at the very least, at the end of the season, they've finally graduated. They're not in the academy anymore. So come the movie, we'll be at the, what was it? The magic.
Department of Magic, I believe.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah.
Mm. Okay.
Wait, you will just... pick up even more people for her harems.
I was actually quite surprised with the movie, actually. I thought they were just going to announce another season, but nope.
Yeah. Again, this is why I brought this up with this when the slime movie was announced, that I just think there's probably not what they want to adapt next won't fit into a full season.
Yeah, that's true though. That's
like the next arc is probably quite short in comparison, so they can't really fit it into a season, so a movie makes sense.
Mm. Yeah.
Okay.
Like Ryu went off when he found out the movie for Villainess was announced. He was just like,
I saw that.
What is this? Yeah, it's just like, dude.
Oh my god. Ryu's been real, man. He's not really into horror shows. Anything horror, don't expect him to give anything higher than a 3 or 2 or 1. So trust me.
He watches it though, and he wonders why it's getting a sequel. Like, it's because you're watching it. They know
it's because people are you already watching it.
Too bad Ryu's not here. That would blow his mind if I told him that.
He's gonna have the surprise Pikachu face like right on the podcast.
Real, if you're watching this, if you know why this is sequel, why are you watching it?
Look inward.
Look inward.
Think what you're doing.
Why you don't drop it? Here's a question for you. Why don't you drop shows that you hate? Why you just give it
just
one?
Just stop watching. Crazy concept, am I right?
But then he would drop pretty much everything.
Yeah, I mean, I'm surprised.
Because he hates everything.
Well, damn!
And drop it then. If I don't enjoy an anime, I would drop it immediately. I don't give a crap about continuing with it.
To be fair, Oliver, you're the same way, right? Because even though you don't like shows, you usually still just watch them till the end.
I don't drop shows.
Yeah.
I drop shows. If I don't enjoy it at all, I just gotta straight up drop it, man.
Either that, or I put them on my hold list and never watch them again.
Which is basically dropping.
Which you would never. Fish is basically dropping it. Dude, trust me.
Fish might be dropping it. Like, so, on my hold list, currently, like, what do we have? Neverland Season 2.
don't even bother, man.
Yeah, don't bother. You might as well just like.
No. Don't bother.
You
with
might as well just delete it. Just
don't
delete
bother
it.
With it.
Just don't. No.
I deleted all my reaction because it was just so bad. I deleted all my, and also because it's also under Aniplex too, so I don't want to risk it too.
That's
so
true. Mm-hmm.
I guess I got my copyright. I guess I got struck by Aniplex last week. 3 copyrights from it, so. I got my channel back. Don't get, but still, I'm scared of Aniplex now. Anything Aniplex, yeah. I just gonna go sub only, just purely sub. So, yeah, I gotta say though, yeah, I mean, I can see why people enjoy Hamifura because they enjoy Harem, they enjoy Isekai, they enjoy Katsurina. I mean, I gotta say though, the one thing that really got me interested enjoying Hamifura is the fact that the voice actors, though, they're really having fun with the roles, though.
Yeah, you can really definitely tell they're having a great time with just what they've been given.
And not just that, like, they're top tier voice actors, too. Like, they're really high rank. Yeah. So, yeah, I think
my favorite episodes of Season 2, though, was the Dollhouse episode. Where they get down into the dollhouse.
Oh, yeah.
And in one of the fantasies, like, all the men are now women and all that. It was just like, what?
What? But my favorite, though.
And all the women are now men.
Wait, Queen, what's your favorite episode?
The play episode.
The play? Oh, yes. Episode 2. Okay. My favorite has to be the Nicole episode, the deep episode. Like, like, that got me, man. That really got me. For some reason, I want Nicole to be with her, actually, more so than Nicole with Katsurina. I want Nicole to be with her more now. Like, after all that, I was like, oh, man, I feel bad for her, man. But she wants to be independent. She wants to be an independent woman. That's like, oh, my God. Touched me really hard, man. But still, though, Katsurina, the thing about Hamifura, they get some deep moments, they get some wholesome moments, they get some dark moments. You just don't know what's coming, man. You just don't know what's coming. But yeah, looking forward to the movie next year, sometime next year. But yeah, just enjoy the show for what it is, man. So what's the last show we're talking about again?
Love Live Superstar.
Love Live.
Oh,
Love Live. Yeah.
Love Live Superstar. I still need to replace my Love Live shirt because I only
Kanan is best girl.
I guess I still got Kanan, man. She's always forever best girl. But guess who's my second best girl? Guess who is my second best girl?
There's quite a few now.
I mean, here's a hint. Nijikasaki.
Okay. Oh my God! What is her name?
It's not Nico, is it?
Nico.
Oh my God! What the hell is her name? I can't remember.
Queen.
Hmm.
Right there.
Yeah, you're pointing at her. I just can't see.
Setsuna Yuki. She's my second favorite girl, man. Trust me. Her song hits, man. Her song really hits.
I think we can all agree, though, who our favorite character for Superstar is, right?
Cuckoo?
Oh, my. Love her. She steals, like, every little moment.
By the way, the amount of people Chinese people watching Love Live now just risen. Like, the amount of Chinese people speak Chinese, people watch Love Live now because guess why? Cuckoo speaks Chinese in the first episode. I actually made a moment video of it about it in my third channel. Guess how many views I got?
A lot.
Over a million.
100,000 views.
Ooh.
for over over 400 comments. I read through all of them, and they're like a mix of people who are Chinese. There were mixed opinion on a Chinese being spoken by Liu, man. By the way, Liu is from Shanghai, so I can understand she speaks some good Chinese. But people say that the Chinese is cringe, the Chinese is well-spoken compared to other animes. But for me, as a Chinese speaker, though, that's some good Chinese compared to other like animes where they speak some
broken Chinese. Because in fact that we always get English in anime.
Yeah,
it's just a refreshing sign, man. I mean, Cuckoo just speaks Chinese, though. She just speaks some like quick phrase words like, oh,
she speaks a hybrid of like both in a way.
Yeah. Maybe because, you know, the majority of the viewers are like Japanese. They don't want to like trouble the Japanese people with some random Chinese. So,
if Superstar, the latest episode I watched was the reveal that, what's her name?
Ren?
Ren. Yeah, Ren. The reveal that Ren is living on her own because her parents have passed away and the school is going to be closed. Where have I heard that plot before?
I think I've heard of. I've heard the plot before, man. Like
twice before. I can't remember where.
Okay, before we get into that, who do you guys think Ren is a good character?
Yeah, I think she's a really interesting character. I kind of need like a little bit more out of her.
Yeah.
Because everyone else kind of shines and she's just there. So I'm hoping that the next few episodes she gets like a little more time.
I found this good meme on Love Live fan page. Look at this.
Is that a Naruto reference?
All of that behind her are the previous members. I put it in the group chat. Oh my god, dude. I look at this meme, I say, makes sense. The latest episode makes sense, man. Dude, the latest episode is just any other Love Live episode. Kanon gonna do the typical protagonist thing. Bring the Seto Kaijo to the team. I was like, oh, this is repeated again and again and again.
Oh my god.
We saw it coming, like, man.
Superstar's got a manga.
Oh yeah, those manga adaptation run, like the spin-off mangas and stuff like that. I read it already. I've seen it before. But going back to like Rendo, I don't know why. I can really piss people off by saying this, but she looks almost like a rip-off version of Kanon.
Oh damn.
The thing is though, you could argue that all the characters are rip-offs of the previous
original
Love Live. That's the thing. Like Kanon is freaking, you know,
Chika. Although Cuckoo though, she's very unique though. I gotta say Cuckoo is very unique.
Cuckoo's kind of in her own space.
Yeah,
it's just like everybody else.
The way she speaks though, it's just so fun to watch, man. Like the strange voice she produces, Liu having so much fun doing all those like strange Cuckoo voice. It's just like, oh man, she's like a very refreshing sight to watch, man.
The sound.
Yeah. Oh, Sumire is just Yohane, man. Sumire is just straight up Yohane. Yoshiko, Yohane, man. Sumire is just like, oh man, she's just another version of Yohane, but more enjoyable. And then Chito Sedo is just like, I don't know, she says like, I don't know, who's she, I mean, looking at Chito Sedo, she's almost like, what did she come up with? What do you think of Chise, actually?
Chise.
The white hair.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. She's kind of like Kotori and Umi mixed together.
Okay.
I mean, only because of the fact is like she's known Kanon for like such a young age. And such. I'm like, okay, I get that.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
The childhood friend sort of like situation.
Yeah. I don't mind her at all that much. Like, I think she's a pretty good character. Like, yeah, I mean, all the characters are
really well written
good this time.
Yeah, I gotta say, very well written.
I like the fact that the group is a lot smaller than 9 girls.
Yeah, that's true, though.
It is hard to get like so much development for 9 girls. So with 5, it's like hella easy, in my opinion.
Yeah, like the original Love Live had 9. The what's the
Sunshine.
Trying to think of
Sunshine.
Sunshine
had 9 or 7, something like that.
Seven. I think mm-hmm. 7. Yeah.
And then the late, the second one off, wait, before this one. Then we had Nisugaki High School.
9.
Which was 1, 2, 3. 9. Yeah, 9 again. So. Mm-hmm.
The reason why I know, because all 9 episodes, the first 9 episodes, just they have their own solo song.
Focus on them, yeah.
Yeah, that's why I know. And then you can say, like, Muse, the original, is like, I think it was a 7 or 8 or 9. But anyhow, but this time is 5, though. That's why people can, you know, connect with them more. Because, like, you learn more about them better. I mean, Ren needs more character to her, to be honest, in my opinion.
Yeah, Ren definitely probably needs more character development. But the rest are pretty damn good.
Although, I have a feeling that, I don't know why, but when Cuckoo said that she came from Shanghai to Tokyo to pursue her passion in idol rather than studying, and you know she ran away, she basically have her own apartment and stuff like that. I don't know why. I have a deep feeling that later in the season, maybe then the final 4 episode, we're gonna see Cuckoo's being dragged back home or something like that. I won't be surprised.
Wouldn't surprise me at all.
Yeah, Cuckoo's been dragged back. Cuckoo's like the one to start all this.
We still have a couple of episodes left, but do you guys think we'll be getting a second season?
Obviously. Oh, of course, man. Hey, Nichikasaki got a second season. Why did this cannot get a second season?
Yeah, they announced the second season for that like straight away, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
By the way, Nichikasaki is my favorite so far, in my opinion, because like we get to see more characters in them. But yeah,
that one was really good.
Actually, well, here's the thing.
I always have a soft spot for the original Muse.
Nichikasaki is good when Ryo gave it a 9.
Oh. Yes. Yes. Yeah, good point.
That's true.
You know it's good when Ryo gave it a 9. And that's what got Ryo to start watching Love Live. Ryo actually started watching Love Live because of Nichikasaki.
Oh, wow. That's interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He caught up. I don't know how he did it, but he caught up with Love Live.
He watches like, come on, he watches like 1,000 episodes a day, so.
Yeah, he watches all kinds of shows, so not usually idol shows, until Love Live.
Until Nichikasaki is good when he gave it now, but Superstar though, he said that. I don't know. I'm not sure whether I agree with him or not. But I'm not sure whether Oliver and Queen will agree to this. But he say they're starting to go back to the roots, like saving the school again. Do you think we can go back to the whole saving the school concept?
Well, they brought it up in the
latest episode. Yeah, they kind of already did it, especially with this last episode.
With Ren bringing it up, like the school closing, I was just like, oh great, here we go.
Not closing. There were applicants, not enough applicants for next year and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So.
Which is exactly like the original.
Almost, yeah, that's just. But the original, they saved the school. But I'm not sure whether it's Superstar.
Yeah, and then Aquas, they lost their school. Okay, what are we going to see with these girls? Are they going to save? Are they not? So.
Can we just have a Love Live show without the saving of the school plot?
Nichikasaki is basically very refreshing because like you see more idol passion into it rather than we're doing this also to save the school. So that's what Nichikasaki really like hits for me and stuff like that. But I'm just hoping that Superstar doesn't really tackle the whole like cliché-ness of the previous franchise and stuff like that. But again, though, maybe they're going to do something like about like Cuckoo situation. Maybe I won't be surprised if that's going to happen. But yeah, I mean, what I was about to say again? Give me a sec. What do you guys think of the opening, though? What do you guys notice about the scenes in the opening?
Ring in the RP.
Yeah. Mm. Where were they performing?
Well, I would assume that they're performing.
Well, it's a stadium, right?
Yeah, it's a stadium.
It's the Olympic National Stadium.
Oh, okay. I didn't know that.
They were performing at the National Olympic Stadium.
That's cool.
That shows how big they have Love Live has become. Dude, you know Love Live, also you know Love Live is big when they just hire my favorite voice actor Kana Hanazawa to voice the maid. You like my girl
Kana Hanazawa. I didn't even know that was her until when I went back.
when the maid spoke for the first time, I said, Kana Hanazawa, what the hell? Yo, my girl! Oh, dude, she came in just to voice the maid, not some big characters. It's like, oh my god. Also, by the way, the dog looked like Shiitake from...
Yes!
Also, the poop reference, by the way. The poop reference from Nico. The poop reference, I was like, oh my god, the reference. The reference to Nico.
Hey, I just... Good. Random topic, but I just noticed that if you go and click on all the characters and stuff for the shows now, they've Mal's actually updated it so you can actually see the favorites of like how many people have favorited the characters.
Mm.
That's really? New.
Yeah, of course. Of course,
that, we all that's know never, that. That's happened. That's not. But yeah, that's brand new. I haven't seen that happen before.
Mm.
And it seems like. Yeah, Keke is the Keke's not the one with the most favorites. Canon is.
That's girl.
Canon, I mean, maybe because of the orange hair effect, I guess. The orange hair effect.
Orange hair.
I mean, okay, see, here's my thing. Like, I love her so freaking much, but when we compare her to like everybody else, every different orange hair, like I can't stand freaking is it Haruka? Yeah.
Honoka.
Yes, thank you. Can't stand her. I like at first I was okay with it, but then I think one day I rewatched it and I was just like, I can't. Love Chika to death. I think Chika's just adorable, but
Chika, I mean Chika's fun. Chika's a fun character, man. Chika's a fun character. Although like Kanondo, I can't really see much of a character. I mean, she has some funny moments to her, of course, like the facial expressions, facial reactions. But Cuckoo does a better job, to be honest. Cuckoo has better.
Oh, yes.
I think that what the driving force right now for Superstar is Cuckoo. Is Cuckoo, man. And Sumire. Sumire and Cuckoo. The dynamic relationship. Oh my god, dude. Sumire and Cuckoo is just like those two are just like meme worthy, man. Those two are just so have so much character to them. I mean, Sumire, like I said, she's like another version of Yohane, but yeah. She's, but yeah, Cuckoo right now, because not only the fact that she has some like good voice acting moments too, but also like the amount of Chinese people watching Love Live now just increased by a lot, man. Oh my god, people start watching more Chinese people watch Love Live because of Liyu. Because Liyu is already a big YouTuber, by the way. She's like very big in China. So she's just been brought in just to... increase more viewers for Love Live.
And it's like, her very first acting role too.
Yeah, of course. All of them are first acting role. All of them are like first newbies. And
Lilo did the theme song for that show. I'm Standing on a Million Lives.
I did not listen to it. Sorry, but yeah.
You know, when I think about it, being like voice acting Love Live, that sounds like a really great way to start off your voice acting career. Considering how popular Love Live is.
Trust me. There's more. Love Live trends for 2 hours every Sunday, okay? Number 120 every Sunday. In Japan server, of course, in the Japan side of things. But like Love Live, like every time I went on every time, like 5 p.m. my time, Love Live airs on in NHK. It was like training for 2 hours. I was like, makes sense, I guess.
Yeah, it makes sense.
Yeah, but also like not only that, because like there's more Love Live followers on Twitter too compared to other animes. And you know, if you debut yourself on Love Live, you get more people know your role. Also, the thing Love Live does really well that get more fans is because they do a lot of like seiyuu shows. Like every week they do a seiyuu show, like at least twice. Like, say you talk about the roles in each episode, they do some fun games and stuff like that. They engage with the viewers and stuff like that. That's why Love Live does really well. And that's why Love Live earns so much money. And that's why Sunrise dropped Extra World and decided to focus on Love Live. So, yeah. Sunrise is You think Ufotable is earning a lot of money? Nope. Sunrise earning hell out of money from Love Live, man.
Understandable. The idol culture is still really big in Japan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Although Zombieland Saga is rising, but nowhere near Love Live level, man. Nowhere near Love Live level. Love Live is just in another world right now. I wouldn't be surprised after Superstar we're going to get another like six girls, seven girls or something.
I've said this a while back, and I'll say it again. What I kind of want them to do is bring back some of the old cast, like bring back Muse and stuff, just for like a cameo. Just like we just have do a show, do like bring in new characters and stuff, but then like
the thing is also
get to the love, have them have to get them to the Love Live, have them win Love Live, but then. The persons that, you know, the people that, you know, present them the trophy or whatever is, you know, a previous team, like Muse or those in Sunshine or something like that. It's like,
I was also wondering about that too. But I think the reason why we don't see any cameos is because, like, maybe of the contract situation regarding to Seiyu's go coming back for some of the roles too. Yeah, because, plus, like,
All-Stars.
Yeah. I don't know about the contracts of the actors and stuff, so maybe that's
also it, because the one thing that really surprises me is that how is it that Aqua is still ongoing? Like Muse is just like literally when Muse finish. Aqua is still ongoing to now. And if Aqua is still ongoing, won't they like have some moments to debut in Superstar Nijigasaki or something like that? But no. No, maybe because that made me wondering. Maybe because of the contract situation, say, oh yeah, so after anime ends, you guys just focus on the music videos and stuff like that. Don't do stuff like anime and episode and cameo and stuff like that. So maybe something like that. But I don't really I don't really know much because like I don't think they actually mentioned it in any of the talks and stuff like that. I mean, maybe people can comment below and tell me about it more, but. Yeah, I gotta say though, Superstar has potential. It's just that they need a bit more to Ren character because Ren is just basically being one of those Seto Kaichos and stuff like that. Just being very strict and just do. I mean, she joined them, but I don't know. Like, what can she add to the team? Like, she says like the dance of Sumire is because of her. What's Sumire? What can she add again? More of her like showbiz of like moments too, like you know, doing some like good dances. Cuckoo is just like the lyrics of the song. Kanon is just the instrumental, and Ren is just like, what can she do? Like I was wondering, what can she do? Maybe her ballet dancing maybe can add to some of the dancing, but yeah, to be honest though, I like Ren for what she is. It's just that she's not my favorite girl. She's just not there yet for me because she needs more time to shine. And I find it even more weird is that why can't she just move out of the mansion? Why keep on staying there? Just move out, man. So, yeah, I mean, Oliver, you haven't watched episode 8 yet, right?
No, I still have to watch the episode 8, so I'll hopefully do that soon.
Yeah, episode 8 is just like, it's a good episode. It's just that I felt like could be like the next episode 9. That's where we really see the blooming of Ren. Like I want episode 8 to see more Ren backstory and stuff like that. I feel like the whole backstory of Ren is just kind of rushed, to be honest. There's not enough. No, not enough like source to say, oh my god, I really feel for her. But it's just like there, just to make us feel bad for her. It's just like, oh, so what? Move on. And then Kanon do. And then Kanon just being Kanon, just using talk no jutsu to tell her to like join the idol and stuff like that. It's just like, it's the same trope again. It's the same Love Live trope. So. Well, let's just see how they end the season, man. Let's just see how they're going to end the season.
I will say this, though, that unlike the previous seasons with Ren, with her backstory, like, I think it's the first time, like, we've had a parents are dead backstory.
Yeah. Mm.
So that's new.
Her father, though, is abroad, though. Her father lives abroad.
Yeah.
So. Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah. Good point. So maybe that's why she has to stay in the mansion, because, you know, if the dad finally comes home, like...
Maybe she just didn't want to have to lose all the memories of the place with the mom.
That's another one.
I mean, fair play for the maid, though, to like, stay loyal to Ren, though. But yeah, I gotta say, it's fair play for her to stay loyal. So, I mean, looking forward to see the final four episode, which... I think this next four episodes should be the defining moment for the season, whether it's a good season or a very like typical Love Live season.
Yeah, so... I think so too.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so... Yeah, I mean... The songs are good, don't get me... Oh, yeah, we haven't really talked about the song. What do you guys think of the songs? Yeah, like that?
I've enjoyed them so far.
Yeah, I think they're really good.
They're really good. I mean, my favorite, though, has to be... which was it called again? I think it's called...
I'm thinking back over the ones that I've seen.
I think for me, it's between the opening song... And then the most recent song from the recent episode.
To be honest, though, all the songs this season is quite okay for me, to be honest. Nothing really...
If we were talking about, like, the solos, I think, because some of the copies that I have, you get to see, like, a little mini music video and such. Of course, Kanan for me, because best girl. That's all.
I thought you said Kanan for a second, but okay, Kanan, okay. Wait, Queen, who is your favorite girl for Love Live franchise?
Oh, okay. So for Muse, it's Nozomine. For Aquas, it is Yohane. And then for Nichikasaki, it is... her name starts with a K. It's coming to me. Oh my god. It's freaking Nezuko's Seiyu, her character.
Oh, Kanata.
Yes,
Kanata. Oh, I love her, man. I really like her cool, breezy personality. Oh, yeah, Oliver, who is your favorite character?
For each season?
In general, if you want, in general, it's fine too.
Well, for me, like I said, Keke in Superstar is pretty good. I like her. In the original series, I always like Nozomi, but I also like Maki as well.
The tsundere girl.
Our red hair tsundere.
Like, for a while, it was Nico from the original series, but looking back now, not so much. But with the... I'm just trying to get to Sunshine. Sunshine is more difficult. I didn't really connect with any of the characters from Sunshine. Like, I don't really have any favorites, I mean.
Oh, yeah, it makes sense. Sunshine is the weakest season, the weakest franchise. Sunshine
is honestly really weak. In fact, I never actually scored it, so.
Oh, damn. I mean, yeah, surprisingly though, Sunshine is not my favorite franchise, even though my number one favorite girl in Love Live is Kanan. Oh my god. I don't know what is it about Kanan. It's just that she has this sort of cool vibe to her. That's what I like about her. And Setsuna is just, again, another cool vibe to her. That's what I like about Setsuna too, Setsuna Yuki. So I think I like cool girls. Maybe that's the reason. Cool girls.
Cool girls are pretty great.
Cool.
But Superstar though, like, I still need time to get used to the characters though. Like, all five of them is good, don't get me wrong. It's just that it's not there yet to say, oh my god, waifu material. But it's just that I enjoy them for what they are, just to do what they do. So looking forward to like seeing how these final four episodes go, because like, this final four episode could either be a hit or miss, in my opinion. Like, they could either make it a very dramatic final four episode or make it a very wholesome final episode. So, looking forward to seeing a bit of both. Yeah, that could happen. Like season one for the new season one, like we got Katori leaving, quitting the group, and maybe something like that could happen with Cuckoo because of the parent, because of the situation with the parents. But
and also in the original season, we had of course Honoka overdoing and passing out as well.
Yep.
We haven't seen that happen in a while. We haven't seen a character pass out in a while, so that could happen.
So basically, the Muse is the groundwork. Basically, anything we can relate to most stuff from Muse. Basically, it's just that I can't believe it's been like so long since Muse finished too. Like back in 2015, the movie. Wow, damn, it's been that long, man.
Yeah, the first season freaking aired in 2013. So
that's crazy.
That was a long time ago.
Love Life fans are quite loyal, actually. They always root for new projects and stuff like that. So,
oh yeah.
I mean, I am a Love Life fan, but you can say I'm not like one of those hardcore fans that go to every concert, you know, get all the merch.
I can't do that. I can't travel like, at the moment anyway. So
I'm just a fan. How about Queen though? Do you call yourself like a big Love Life fan or something?
More of a fan. Now, if we were like comparing like Idolmaster and Bang Dream.
Bang Dream. Oh yeah. Are you a Bang Dreamer? Are you a big Bang Dreamer?
Yes.
Are you a big? Join the club, man. Join the club.
Rosalia. You can't really see like right here. That's all Rosalia pictures right there.
Oh my god, dude, join the club! Join the club! Rosalia! My favorite. I got a gigantic Rosalia poster right here. I can't think it's... you can see right there, there's a Rosalia picture right there too, so...
Well, dude, for years I had the 2013 Love Live movie poster on my door. So... I had that since I saw the film in 2015, so...
Are you looking forward to the Rosalia movie, by the way? A bit off topic.
Yes.
Are you looking for? Wait. Do you watch? You can go on the streaming site to watch it. Like there's like a website you can go and pay to watch it.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. I need to wait for the pirate version of it. Sorry, guys.
I know. Like I missed part one, and I know part two is still out. So I might just like wait until like
I'm waiting. Comes out. I'm waiting for part one. I can't just dive into part two, but.
Right.
But yeah, I gotta say, Yukina, best girl, man. Come on, the cool again, another
it's
cool
Lisa
character
for me.
Oh yeah, I know. I saw all your tweets, man. I saw all your retweets and stuff like that. I know. I can understand with Lisa because she's another one of those like high energy girl, and you know she's very supportive. She always smiles. Actually, I never really saw her sad once. I mean, there is one time, but that's like just because you know Sayo just fainted. So
yeah.
Yeah, I gotta say, Rosalia, I really like all the cast. Yukina is just being Yukina, just very cool vibe to her. And when she smiles, she's like, what a treasure thing you can experience, man.
I know, it's just so precious.
Okay, that's why I'm so looking forward to the movie, because we're actually gonna witness her cry, man. I remember seeing it from the trailer that she cried in one scene, so I was like, oh my god, give me the movie already, man. Oh my god. So, yeah, wait, Oliver, have you heard of Bang Dreams?
I have heard of it. I've just never obviously watched it. But I know Bang Dream, yes.
Yeah, Bang Dream is basically another one of those like big... But I would say Idol is just like one of those big music sort of like franchise that you can like, you know, you have a lot of cute girls doing music and stuff like that. But it's just Bang Dream. Is that the thing about what I like about Bang Dream compared to Love Live? It's just like, you know, like the music at least have more like this sort of like stronger like feeling to it. Like the Love Live song is just like, it's good. It's just that it's just like one of those idol songs. But for Bang Dream, it's just like the guitar works, the drum work. It's just like, dude, love
wow,
it.
Wow, I just looked up the first season of Bang Dream on MAL, and that's quite a low MAL score, things considered.
Really?
Well, I mean, I would say because like season one focuses on like the main group hopping party. So I would still watch it if I was you. But like if you look at like season two and season three, that's really where like everybody truly gets their focus.
Yeah, I mean, season two is where it starts to drift off now to like focus more on band members.
Yeah.
Season three again,
now,
though.
I see that the mouse call jumps. Like it keeps jumping higher and higher with each passing season.
Mm.
So, yeah, 6.97 for season 1, 7.58 for season 2, and then I'm whopping 8.05 for the third season. So
damn,
that must be really good.
Well, that's probably them Razor Ceiling fans.
Yeah, Razor Ceiling fans, man. Razz. Oh my god. Even though I'm not much of a Razz fan, to be honest, but you can say Razz is the driving force because Razz got a lot of development that season.
Yeah.
Holy cow, I wasn't expecting that, but yeah, I mean, I would love to see season 4, but not right now. They're focusing on the movies, the band movie, the band members movie. Rosalia is out right now, popping parties next year, and then after that it's like Razz maybe, so yeah, we won't be seeing season 4 anytime soon, man. I'm gutted, but the movies, man.
I mean, between that, they're focusing on that stuff, and then I think it's the same people who do Bang Dream. They're also doing D4 DJ as well.
Oh, yeah, that's true, though. D4 DJ.
That's another one. I've heard of that one as well.
Yes.
So. I did not watch it because, like, I wasn't really into the whole DJ music, but yeah. No, trust me. I watched the music videos and stuff like that. I was like, not really.
What music video did you watch?
I forgot. I remember like seeing on YouTube that like, was recommended to me. I just like watch it. I was like, okay. Nope, not for me, man. But again,
you might like oh my god, what's her name? Freaking Rondo. Rondo's like very similar to Rosalia, so you might like them.
You want to like tag? You want to post one video into the group chat? I can go to it.
Sure.
Okay. I'll look forward to checking out that one. But yeah, don't expect me to pick up DJ4, whatever that thing I'll call it again. So yeah, anything else you want to say about Superstar for the season? Looking forward to the final four episodes?
I'm looking forward to the final four episodes. I'm very curious to see how this
storyline like about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. In season. I want to see if they can, if they really are going to do the saving the school plot for a third time.
Okay, so this time it's a flip of coin to save school close down or school no close down. Let's just see, man. Let's just see. Yeah. You can go both ways. There's no in between. Well,
We've done both already. We've got one that saved the school and one that hasn't saved the school. So maybe this time it'll be save the school again.
Or maybe, just maybe, the school merge with another school.
Or maybe it's somewhere in the middle. The school is just in a little bit of trouble.
Yeah, that could happen. They never dealt with the situation. The school is still like having applicants, but like just like minimal below average. So they're still getting people coming in. So yeah, I mean, sure. But yeah, I mean, so that's basically the four shows for this season we're going to talk about, I guess.
Yeah, so yeah. So even though we didn't talk about all the shows this season, what do you guys think about the summer 2021 season in general?
Like I said, Makia Record coming into the season saved me, man.
That saved honestly really saved it for me.
Saved me, because I love Makia Record. And by the way, you gotta agree with me, Queen, that the animation is so much better. The storytelling is so much better in second season, man. Shaft Studio really flexed, man, in some episodes, especially like the fight scenes.
I've never seen it, so yeah. I think for me, Slime is definitely the top tier of the season for me, followed by Kobayashi. Those two were definitely the highlights of this season.
Mm-hmm. A quick word with Kawaii. What do you think of Tsukimichi in general?
Let's see. Well, honestly, I think this show is just okay. I mean,
the final two episodes, though.
Final two episodes were standout. But aside from those episodes, I thought it was just okay. I mean, like, yeah, it was.
It's just like a world building. It's just world building.
It basically is just world building. I mean, it's not like. It's not too action heavy either, and honestly, like, I mean, yeah, it does have like a fair bit of comedy, but it's mostly around like Tomoe and Mio and their relationship with Makoto, and that does work sometimes, but like a lot of times it just felt kind of flat for me.
I can agree that it gets repetitive after a while. But maybe because the final two episodes kind of kickstart what to expect from season two. Maybe they get more battle stuff going on too, but. Yeah, we shall see, man.
Yeah, especially with the whole revelation of like the whole war between like the demons and the humans, apparently. Also,
Do you watch Vanitas? Do you watch Vanitas?
Vanitas? No. I didn't see that, but I want to watch it. I want to watch it.
I thought you watched it though, because they used to show.
No. I've seen like clips here and there, but like no, I haven't sat down and watched it.
Wait, what do you watch this season?
I didn't check that. Oh god.
Well, obviously you watch Super Skills. What's Love Live, obviously.
Obviously.
Of course, Kobayashi.
I watched Magia Recore, the Honor Student of Magic High School, Aquatrope, Pretty Cure, because chick is obsessed with Pretty Cure.
Oh yeah, you watch what's it called again? What is the show?
What, Tropical Heroes Pretty Cure?
No, not Aquatrope. Like what's the other one? Mahoka.
The Honor Student at Magic High School?
Yeah.
She watches that, yeah.
What do you think of it, honestly? Like, I feel like...
I mean, okay, we're not really done with it. I know it's supposed to be done this weekend. Because of the fact is, it's literally the same thing
season one.
Yeah.
Except it's like, Miyuki's side of it. Mm. I mean, it's interesting. Some episodes are, like, good, and then some are very, like, boring and such, but it's just like, okay, like,
I really feel like that whole spin-off thing could have been just released after season one. Like, why leave it so late? Leave it so late. People forgot what happened in season one. So,
yeah. I mean, but for me, since it's like, I watched it last year because I binged the dang thing.
Oh,
so
yeah.
It was just like, still like, oh, it was nice to see certain things and like maybe some extended scenes and some ish. But yeah, overall, it was okay.
I feel like this spin-off also have a lot more fan service-y moments too.
Yeah.
Like, holy shit. I mean, the latest episode with Miyuki in the shower, I was like, oh my. Oh.
Woo!
Oh, shit. Because, you know, I'm a Miyuki fan right there too. My girl Miyuki right there.
She's great.
Yeah, she's a waifu. But yeah, you can say, like, I guess I watched season one when it was released in 2014.
Mm-hmm.
All those years ago. And I kind of forgotten most what happened. Like when I watched the spin off, I was like, oh, that happened again. Oh yeah, that did happen. My bad. But yeah.
I had those moments too, because I was like, that happened. I was like, oh, okay.
Okay.
For me, it was still pretty recent, because I think I reacted to season one back in, I think it was like either this year or last year. So
it was last year.
Yeah, it might have been last year.
You watched season two. I remember you watched season two, so.
Oh no, I never watched season two.
Oh, you didn't watch season two?
I never watched
season two. You didn't watch season two? Oh, really? You didn't watch season two? Yeah. Okay. So,
did you watch the movie?
No, I didn't. But I heard, like, yeah, you have to watch, like, the movie before season two.
Yeah, because it gets really confusing on, the new girl and everything and such. Because I was confused.
Yeah, I literally watched the movie after season two finished. I was like, okay, now that makes
sense. No, I watched the movie before season two, and I was confused.
Now everything makes sense with Lena and stuff like that. I gotta say, I mean, looking forward to see whether we get season three now, but who knows, man. Maybe on Saturday after the spin-off finishes it. Oh, yeah. Guess what? We're getting season three. Oh god.
Let's hope it picks up right where season two leaves off. We don't have to see some movie or something in order to understand what's happening.
Well, we shall see, man.
We've been getting a lot of movie announcements recently, so it is possible.
Yeah, we got we got a villainess movie. We got a slime movie. I mean, what's next? It's absolutely crazy. All right.
What's next? Maybe.
We got a villainess movie as well.
Yeah, villainess movie. We got a slime movie. A lot of sequel announcements.
Maybe a Higurashi movie.
Is that even I heard a lot of things about the new season. Is that even like doing well, or
I mean the latest episode was fire though, I gotta say. But yeah, everything else is just like kind of repeated, to be honest.
Gotcha.
But yeah, so that's it for the summer season before I start ranting about Day of Life for next season.
I think that's about it.
Yeah, I think we've wrapped everything up.
All right, so are we ready to wrap up this podcast?
Can I just say a bit about Day of Life for next season?
Here we go.
Sure.
Geek Toys, I know that you guys will be watching this podcast, but what's the deal, man? seriously, why are you leaving so late to announce, to not only release the PB, but also to also delay it? Like, they announced season 4 literally last year. No, actually, not just last year, 2 years ago.
Really?
And yeah, 2 years ago. It was leaked.
Damn.
It was leaked 2 years ago. Last year was, how do I put this though? Just confirming that there will be a season 4. And this year, during the Kodokawa light novel show, they probably showed the first teaser PV, which was not even nothing much to it. But, and then 6 months later, they decided to release the official PV and say, oh, 2022. Even though they were actually marketing it for next season and the light novel sales and stuff like that for Tachibana's new work and stuff like that too. So I was like, oh my God, Geek Toys. You guys, I know you guys are like a small studio, but can't you guys do a better job in just, you know, announcing stuff? For God's sake, I got my hopes up pretty well, man. I got my resources ready. I got everything ready for their live reaction next season. But nope, bye bye. Wait next year.
Blue ball.
They didn't even wait which season to announce it. For God's sake, if they say 2022 fall season, I gotta make a brand video. Seriously, man. Winter season makes sense. Spring season, I'll allow it. Summer season,
no.
I'll pinch myself to accept it. But fall season next year, I'm making a rant video. So, yeah, I gotta say though, Geek Toys. I mean, you guys saw the PV, right?
Is it the I read? Yeah, I think so. If we're talking about the same PV, like unless there's a new PV coming out, but yeah, I saw the PV.
Yeah, the quality compared to the fucking JC staff is so much better, man.
It does look pretty good.
That was more animation in the trailer for season 4 than there was for the entirety of season 3.
Exactly. Although a lot of people are having opinions to Toka's character design, though. But I will leave it for that.
I think she looks fine. I mean, yeah, she does look a little bit different. Yeah, I think she looks fine.
She looks a lot better than she was in season 3.
People already accepted Kurumi character design because, you know, Dear Bullet movie came out. So,
which I can't watch.
Trust me. Dear Bullet will spoil you for Kurumi backstory, man. But, but yeah, I can say that people having mixed opinion already on the animation of the character design. But I say, dude, at least it's better than JC Staff rather than stick like animation, yes. Okay? Oh my God. I'm part of the Daylight community on Facebook. People are like commenting saying, oh my God, the animation looks so weird. And it's like, how is it weird? It's better than JC Staff. Have you seen the poster for JC Staff? Dude, all open mouth.
I think I remember that as well. I was like, what is, yeah, I think I remember that. It was like a lot of people were getting JC Staff flack about that.
Also, the reason why I was so hyped up with the PV for next season, because they're actually gonna adapt the scenes that they cut out on the last episode of Day of Life, season 3.
Oh, really?
And that's why I was actually really pissed off, because they cut out the scene and made it some sort of anime original scene, but they decided to add that scene now into hopefully the start of season 4. And that's why I'm looking forward to next season. But nope, we have to wait till next year. Thank you, Geek Toys.
I would have freaking laughed if the PV was actually like an up, like, and it turns out it's like a remake of season 3.
Oh no!
They would have just gone like, yeah, you know the one from JC. Like so, just forget about that. Just forget about that. This is season 3 here.
I won't be surprised if they do something like that. But again, though, I mean, they introduced the two new spirits already, so we're gonna get a proper season four. We're gonna have a proper season 4, man. So, oh well, looking forward to when the next announcement for maybe this Saturday, because there's like a special Dear Live event this Saturday. So I'm looking forward to see what sort of information they're gonna announce. So.
Yeah, hopefully it doesn't get delayed to like 2023 or something. Otherwise, Mad Light might actually go fight somebody.
They've already said that's going to come out next year. So if they push it back another year after that, then they're going to have problems.
Yeah,
they're going to have problems. trust me, Trust me, I'll literally just make a rant video, just talk nonstop about it for 10 minutes.
Oh yeah, I'd imagine.
Should we keep an eye on you during this when they do the Dead Alive announcement thing? Because if they say coming Christmas 2022, you're just going to be gone.
Trust me. I won't be happy if they delay to next fall. Not just for like next fall.
He's legit just gonna go over Japan, just fight somebody.
On Twitter, I'll hashtag. I'll add Geek Toys, add Kurokawa. What's the deal? By the way, guys, it actually works when you hashtag, when you add Kurokawa at Dead Alive, because I always ask you, hey, Dead Alive, when's the next PV? I did it like 3 times, they released the PV.
Oh, shit, yeah, they were afraid, man. They were intimidated. You surely did something.
Oh, my God, man.
I'm thinking Mad Lad, like does a live reaction to the... you know, next announcement trailer, like we're watching him. And so, let me finish. They announced Christmas 2022. You get out of your seat. I'm going to Japan.
And by the way,
I got my plane ticket right here. Don't fuck with me, Kurokawa.
I can, but Kurokawa is just going to copy strike me. Kurokawa is just going to copy strike me.
Yeah, they're going to split. That's her biggest weakness right there. They're going to exploit it.
Yeah,
so I cannot do it like live streaming the announcement stuff, but I can just watch it my own time and just make a video of it separately. But that's just me with Dead Alive next season. Next season, we can talk more about the fourth season in another podcast. Yeah. So yeah, let's wrap things up.
Let's wrap it up now.
All right. Thank you guys for watching. Have a great day. Subscribe to my channel. Subscribe to these guys' channels. Follow me on Twitter. Support me on Patreon. Links still in the description down below. And I will see you guys next time.